Hello, I'm Maruk Said, your microbiology guide. Let's explore in-depth micro techniques and uncover groundbreaking insight together on this educational journey into the fascinating realms of microbes.
Introduction to retrotransposons. Retrotransposon structure and classification. Detailed structure of lines. Integration process of lines into the genome. Selective transposition mechanism of lines. Functions of retrotransposons. In this video, we'll discuss retrotransposons. Retrotransposons are transposable elements that move from one location to another within the genome using an RNA intermediate. This process involves reverse transcription of the RNA intermediate to form cDNA, which then integrates into a new location. Retrotransposons are quite common and can quickly amplify themselves, making them abundant in eukaryotic genomes. For instance, in maize, they make up 49% of the genome, while in humans, they comprise roughly 42%. Retrotransposons are broadly classified into two groups, LTR retrotransposons and non-LTR retrotransposons. LTR retrotransposons are virus-like and resemble retroviruses, whereas non-LTR retrotransposons differ significantly from LTR retrotransposons. Non-LTR retrotransposons lack a specific feature and have a polyadenylated tail, making them more similar to eukaryotic genes. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. Let's start with LTR retrotransposons. These elements have long terminal repeats, LTRs, on both ends. Within the left LTR, there is a promoter sequence where transcription begins, along with a coding region that produces integrase and other enzymes essential for the transposition process. Following a successful transcription round, LTR retrotransposon mRNA is generated. Now, let's see how retrotransposons integrate into the genome. First, the LTR retrotransposon generates mRNA, which is reverse transcribed with the help of reverse transcriptase to form cDNA. This cDNA is then processed by the enzyme integrase, which clips the ends, creating open hydroxyl groups at the three ends. These hydroxyl groups can then attack the target DNA, facilitating the integration of the retrotransposon. This is how they integrate into the target DNA. Subsequently, any open gaps are filled by the cellular repair machinery. This process essentially explains how retroviral retrotransposons become integrated into the genome. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. Now, apart from retroviral or LTR retrotransposons, there are non-LTR retrotransposons. When we discuss non-LTR retrotransposons, lines, long interspersed nuclear elements, and cyanes, short interspersed nuclear elements, come to mind. LINE stands for long interspersed nuclear element, and SINE stands for short interspersed nuclear element. SINEs and LINEs are specific types of retroelements that lack LTRs, but have a poly-A tail, as well as 5 and 3 UTRs, making them similar to eukaryotic genes. They also move via an RNA intermediate. LINEs and SINEs are significant and abundant in eukaryotes, comprising about 34% of the genome. LINEs are autonomous, meaning they can move independently, while SINEs depend on LINEs to jump from one location to another. They vary in size. Mouse LINEs are approximately 6,000 base pairs, whereas human SINEs are around 248 base pairs. In summary, LINEs are larger and SINEs are smaller. Now, let's examine the structure of a line or a poly-A retrotransposon in more detail. Unlike LTR retrotransposons, lines do not have LTRs, but instead have a specific stretch of poly-A tail, which is a common polyadenylation sequence found in eukaryotic genes. This gives them a similarity to eukaryotic genes. They also have 5 and 3 UTRs, similar to eukaryotic genes. Adjacent to the 3 UTR, there is an A/T-rich sequence, which plays an important role in their function. The ORF1 and ORF2 regions encode several proteins. ORF1 encodes an RNA-binding protein, while ORF2 encodes a protein with endonuclease and reverse transcriptase activity. These proteins are essential for the function of line retrotransposons. Let's see how lines get integrated into the genome. Before that, it's important to note that lines encode a protein with both endonuclease and reverse transcriptase activity. This enzyme is crucial not only for line integration into the genome, but also for sign integration. Signs cannot produce their own proteins and rely on lines for the reverse transcriptase and endonuclease necessary for their integration. Let's delve into how signs and lines are integrated into the genome. Initially, line mRNA is transcribed, resulting in mRNA with a 5 UTR and a poly A tail, as expected. The products of ORF2 then bind to this mRNA and guide it toward the target DNA. Typically, line mRNA binds to the A/T-rich regions in the DNA. During integration, a target site cleavage occurs, leading to the formation of an RNA-DNA hybrid. In this situation, the reverse transcription reaction takes place, resulting in the synthesis of the first strand of cDNA. Ultimately, both strands of the cDNA are synthesized, followed by DNA joining and repair mechanisms that incorporate these elements into the genome. This outlines how lines, or non-retroviral retrotransposons, become integrated into the genome. Despite structural differences, there is a similarity in their integration process, as both utilize an RNA intermediate. Certainly, it's an intriguing question. The selective transposition of line mRNAs over other mRNA from a gene Z, despite their similar structures, is indeed fascinating. Studies have shown that the ORF2 products, namely the endonuclease and reverse transcriptase enzymes, have a higher affinity towards line mRNA in a sequence-dependent manner. This selective affinity ensures that lines are integrated into other genomic regions rather than random mRNAs from gene Z. Retrotransposons, like other transposons, can have various effects on the genome. Firstly, they may induce mutagenic effects by jumping from one location to another within the genome, whether they are retroviral or non-retroviral. For instance, if a retrotransposon inserts itself into the middle of an exon, it can disrupt the coding frame, leading to potential mutations. Additionally, retrotransposons can contribute to epigenetic silencing mechanisms. They can also serve as a source of long non-coding RNA and act as enhancers, thereby regulating transcription. In summary, retrotransposons exhibit multiple functions within the genome.
Conclusion: retrotransposons exhibit multiple functions within the genome.
Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, press the bell icon button. Thank you!